When I breathe in, I breathe in.
When I breathe out. Oh, of the human soul.
Sue, love Sue.
We will unite to be apart is to be truly whole.
Sue, love Sue.
We will know the pattern of centuries rise and fall.
Sue, love Sue.
We will know that the fate of one is the fate of all.
Ninhana, Hear the pastor calling from our
inside. When everyone's talking and no one is listening, how can we decide? Do we find the cost of freedom buried in the ground? Mother Earth will swallow you, lay your body down. Do we find the cost of freedom buried in the ground?
For each child that's born, a morning star rises and sings to the universe who we are. For each child that's born, a morning star rises and sings to the universe who we are. We are our grandmother's prayers, and we are our grandmother's dreams. We are the breath of our ancestors. We are mothers of courage and fathers of time. We are daughters of dust and sons of great visions. We are sisters of mercy and brothers of love. We are lovers of life and the builders of nations. We are seekers of truth and keepers of faith. We are makers of peace and the wisdom of ages. We are and we are our grandfather's dreams. We are the breath of our ancestors. We are the spirit of God. We are mothers of courage and fathers of time. We are daughters of dust and the sons of great visions. We are sisters of mercy and brothers of love. We are lovers of life. Seekers of truth and keepers of faith. We are makers of peace and the wisdom of ages. We are our grandmother's prayers, and we are our grandfather's dreams. We are the breath of our ancestors. We are the spirit of God. For each child that's born, a morning star rises.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Virtual Worship with the Unitarian Universalist Church of Silver Spring. I am Carolyn Savadkin, today's worship associate, and my pronouns are she, her. Today's service is the last in our month of exploring the theme of story. This morning, we will honor those who have died in service to this country, remember the origins of Memorial Day holiday, and reflect on the ways that stories help us not to repeat the mistakes of the past. Whether this is the first time joining us for virtual worship or your 51st, I am so glad you are here. Ryan Smith is our welcoming captain and would be glad to answer your questions in the chat. Ryan will also be available during virtual coffee hour after the service. If you're watching live, you can log into Google to participate in the chat in real time. This is a part of how we connect with one another during these services. Comments won't be available for later playback, but during the service, they are very public, so please keep that in mind. Also, the live chat has some safety features to prevent disruptive comments, so you won't be able to post special characters or complete web addresses. A Zoom room, which you can sign into and watch while you also watch the service video, is available for anyone who would like American Sign Language interpretation. If you need help finding that link, please ask in the chat or email vtechsupport@uucss.org. In a few minutes, everyone will be invited to light our flaming chalices. So now is a good time to get a chalice, a candle, or even a flashlight, so you can kindle the flame of community. But let's take a moment to say thank you to those who have made today's service possible. Please join me in the words on your screen as we light our chalices and reaffirm our congregational commitment. May this light warm our hearts with love and caring and guide us in the ways of truth. As we gather here for worship, we pledge ourselves to the endless search for truth, to the right of each to believe as mind, heart, and conscience dictate, to accept the responsibility this freedom commands, and to implement our belief in the essential worth and dignity of every human being. May it be so. Now let's join in singing the song of exaltation. The words to the song will appear on your screen.
We come this day called by war, by the suffering we inflict and endure, when minds across borders fail to reason and compromise. We come this day called by loss, the deaths of those who serve in our name, those whose lives end before their natural course, in service to a cause greater than their own. We come this day called by hope, hope that we will, in some season, finally surrender our swords for plowshares. And we come this day called by peace. May we hear its song. May we proclaim its promise. May our remembrance today renew our struggle. We can never stay or rest. Come, let us worship together.
A song, one with them. Remembering Well, a reflection by Reverend Paul S. Sawyer. The first time I ever played taps was at summer camp when I was 10 years old. That was the year I started playing trumpet, so I can only imagine how it sounded. I know there was no way that I could have hit the high note near the end. The first time I played taps in honor of those who died was in high school, when I was contacted by the local Legion commander. He asked if I would mind occasionally being called on to play taps at graveside services for veterans, and I agreed. For the next couple of years, when there was a need, I would take my place with the Legion Honor Guard, wait for the three volleys of shots to ring out, and play the simple 24 notes of taps as clearly and as best as I could. Each time, the Legion commander would quietly slip me a $10 bill. And that's about all that taps meant to me for a while. It was an easy job to do. It got me out of school, and I earned a little money. And then, one day, that changed. The man I was called upon to play for that day was the father of one of my Boy Scout leaders. Back then, like most of the adults I knew, I thought my assistant scoutmaster was pretty old. But his father was a World War II veteran, so now, thinking back, that means that both my leader and his father were relatively young. Too young for their places there that morning, as the honored dead and as the grieving son. That day, as I began to play taps, this man, who I knew as wise, and kind, and relatively hard in the old Boy Scout, wilderness leader sort of way, fell to his knees, overwhelmed with tears. I am not sure how I made it through the whole piece that day, but after that, I thought I might never be able to play taps again. Today, whether I am playing it or hearing it, taps means something close to what it once meant, to the reasons for which it was written and originally used. Once upon a time, taps was a signal that the camp was relatively safe. It meant that you were not under siege or under attack of any kind. It meant that you were reasonably sure that there were no enemy soldiers to worry about, at least a bugle call's distance away. To a whole camp of soldiers, the notes of taps meant that unless you were on duty, you could close your eyes and you could sleep in peace. And I didn't know that story or that sentiment all those years ago, when I played taps for pocket money in the local cemetery. But in that meaning of taps, something speaks to me in my heart and soul about dying, and for those of us who remain, about remembering well.
For those who have lost a friend or loved one to war, Memorial Day can bring up a lot. It's an especially complicated day for those among us who served and fought beside people who died in battle or even after they returned home. I know many of us bring other sorrows and joys today as well, and this is a prayerful and supportive space for them all. In a moment, all joining us live will be invited to type their joy or sorrow into the chat box during the music. Please keep in mind that everything you share will be public during the live broadcast. If you're having a tough time and need pastoral care, please send an email to layministers@uucss.org, and either they or I will be in touch. But no one needs a special title or training to offer the ministry of love and care to others. I hope everyone will make a note of those among us who could use some extra support this week. And if you're watching the recording of this service later, I invite you to lift up your own joys and sorrows and to hold in loving kindness all those who are in need. Now, let us open our hearts to the joys and sorrows this gathered community has to share.
Thank you.
Spirit of Life. This Memorial Day weekend, we hold in reverent memory all those whose lives have been cut short while serving in the armed forces. We pause to honor their service, whether they signed up willingly or were drafted, whether they agreed with what they were fighting for or not. We pause today to lift up their families and friends, neighborhoods and communities that will never be the same because they are gone. We pause also to pray for those who are serving today, for their safety and for this country to honor their service with good pay and services and benefits. We pause today to lift up the many who have returned home from the battle bearing physical and emotional scars, and to remember the many who leave the battlefield only for that battlefield never to leave them. We pause in the midst of busy daily lives to gather in worship, this thing we do each week that binds us together, expands our horizons, helps us remember our connection to all that is, and draws our focus to the things of deepest worth in our lives and our world. We pray, not because prayer is magic that defies the laws of the universe, not because we all have the same beliefs about prayer or who or what we're praying to, but because prayer is a Unitarian Universalist practice that can change our hearts, our receptivity to one another, and the love and justice at work around us. And so, in our time of worship together, we pray for peace. In this precious time together, we form a guiding vision of a world where we no longer ask people to sacrifice their bodies in order to manage international conflict. Many of us yearn for peace. Our world is thirsty for peace. And yet, as it has been said, there is no real peace without justice. Too often, peace is the word we use when what we really mean is a willingness to ignore a history of wrongs so we don't have to face the truth and all of the ways that truth will ask us to change. But real peace is deeper than that. It means more than a momentary suspension of hard conversations for the sake of political posturing. Peace is more profound than the silent treatment, the tension that exists when it's too hard to engage the real issues. Real peace is deeper than any lull between shouting matches or battles or bombardments. Real peace, the peace that doesn't pass our understanding, can flower only where justice has deep roots. This Memorial Day weekend, let us pray for the courage and commitment to do what it takes to nurture the roots of justice in our own lives and in our own small corners of the world. Let us pray for the patience to stick with those roots of justice even when it all feels in vain. Let us pray for the assurance that our efforts matter, that they are part of a larger whole. May the truth that sings its own song in each of our hearts, the gratitude that leads us to share our abundance with others, the force that topples every tyrant, the power that fills the hungry with good things, may all of that be in us and with us, now and forever. May it be so, and may we make it so. Amen.
This is my song, O God of all the nations. Our reading this morning is an address given by Frederick Douglass at Arlington National Cemetery on Decoration Day, exactly 150 years ago today. Friends and fellow citizens, tarry here for a moment. My words shall be few and simple. The solemn rites of this hour and place call for no lengthened speech. There is in the very air of this resting ground of the unknown dead a silent, subtle, and all-pervading eloquence, far more touching, impressive, and thrilling than living lips have ever uttered. Into the measureless depths of every loyal soul, it is now whispering lessons of all that is precious, priceless, holiest, and most enduring in human existence. Dark and sad will be the hour to this nation when it forgets to pay grateful homage to its greatest benefactors. The offering we bring today is due alike to the patriot soldiers dead and their noble comrades who still live. For whether living or dead, whether in time or eternity, the loyal soldiers who imperiled all for country and freedom are one and inseparable. Those unknown heroes whose whitened bones have been piously gathered here and whose green graves we now strew with sweet and beautiful flowers, choice emblems alike of pure hearts and brave spirits reached in their glorious career that last highest point of nobleness beyond which human power cannot go. They died for their country. No loftier tribute can be paid to the most illustrious of all the benefactors of mankind than we pay to these unrecognized soldiers when we write above their graves this shining epitaph. When the dark and vengeful spirit of slavery, always ambitious, preferring to rule in hell than to serve in heaven, fired the southern heart and stirred all the malign elements of discord. When our great republic, the hope and freedom of and self-government throughout the world, had reached the point of supreme peril, when the union of these states was torn and rent asunder at the center, and the armies of a gigantic rebellion came forth with broad blades and bloody hands to destroy the very foundations of American society. The unknown braves who flung themselves into the yawning chasm where cannon roared and bullets whistled, fought and fell. They died for their country. We are sometimes asked in the name of patriotism to forget the merits of this fearful struggle and remember with equal admiration those who struck at the nation's life and those who struck to save it. Those who fought for slavery and those who fought for liberty and justice. I am no minister of malice. I would not strike the fallen. I would not repel the repentant. But may my right hand forget her cunning and my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth if I forget the difference between the parties to that terrible, protracted, and bloody conflict. If we ought to forget a war which has filled our land with widows and orphans, which has made stumps of men, of the very flower of our youth, which has sent them on the journey of life, armless, legless, maimed, and mutilated, which has piled up a debt heavier than a mountain of gold, swept uncounted thousands of men into bloody graves, and planted agony at a million hearthstones. I say, If this war is to be forgotten, I ask in the name of all things sacred, what shall men remember? The essence and significance of our devotions here today are not to be found in the fact that the men whose remains fill these graves were brave in battle. If we met simply to show our sense of bravery, we should find enough on both sides to kindle admiration. In the raging storm of fire and blood, in the fierce torrent of shot and shell, of sword and bayonet, whether on foot or on horse, unflinching courage marked the rebel, not less than the loyal. But we are not here to applaud manly courage, save as it's been displayed in a noble cause. We must never forget that victory to the rebellion meant death to the Republic. We must never forget that the loyal soldiers who rest beneath this sod flung themselves between the nation and the nation's destroyers. If today we have a country not boiling in an agony of blood like France, if now we have a united country no longer cursed by the hell-black system of human bondage, if the American name is no longer a byword and a hissing to a mocking earth, if the star-spangled banner floats only over free American citizens in every quarter of the land, and our country has before it a glorious career of justice, liberty, and civilization, we are indebted to the unselfish devotion of the noble army who rest in these honored graves all around us.
Before it became a national holiday in 1971, Memorial Day was known as Decoration Day. Now, generations of people had decorated the graves of soldiers who died fighting in all sorts of battles, but the practice became more widely spread after the Civil War, probably because of just how many dead there were. While 360,000 Union soldiers and 258,000 Confederates died in battle, millions are estimated to have died over the course of the war of exposure, disease, and starvation. Nearly everyone lost someone to the war. The earliest story I've been able to find about Memorial Day goes back to the days right after the end of the Civil War. Thousands of Union soldiers had been moved into a makeshift camp on the grounds of a former racetrack in Charleston, South Carolina. The conditions were so bad there that hundreds of the prisoners died of disease and were buried in a mass grave. A few weeks after the South surrendered, more than 1,000 people recently freed from enslavement and a regiment of U.S. colored troops came to the camp to consecrate a new burial site for the soldiers who had fought for the Union, who had fought for freedom. I was born right here in Montgomery County, Maryland in 1983, and even I remember elders who still referred to the Civil War as the War of Northern Aggression when I was a kid. It's unsettling to know that there are still people today who cling to this kind of revisionist history. It's often said that history is written by the winners, but even winning a war to ban slavery couldn't keep white supremacy, the old enemy, from rewriting this country's history. This is why Memorial Day, which began as a way to honor those who had fought for freedom, was turned into a day to honor all who had died in the Civil War, and then all American soldiers who've died in any armed conflict. Equalizing the Union and the Confederacy made it easier for the descendants of slaveholders to revere their ancestors without the bother of cognitive dissonance. This year, perhaps more than any other in my lifetime, it feels important to acknowledge this country's habit of rewriting history. because it's not just Memorial Day that's been whitewashed. It's not just Martin Luther King Jr. Day that's been used to water down and in some cases erase the fullness of that martyr's revolutionary public ministry. It's not just the legends about Thanksgiving being told and retold over centuries so white people can avoid a history of genocide. It's important to acknowledge this pattern because it's happening again. The pandemic, a public health crisis, was slowly but steadily transformed into a politicized issue for debate over personal freedom. Essential workers, initially celebrated for the risks they were forced to take on behalf of our whole society, later were vilified for insisting on hazard pay and safety precautions at work. Those who've collected unemployment after the pandemic took their jobs have suddenly become the bad guys because they'd rather keep collecting a benefit they paid into than take underpaying jobs with few benefits and poor workplace protections. Meanwhile, one of the two political parties with real power in this country refuses to hold accountable those within its ranks who enabled the January 6th attack on the Capitol. The right frames the insurrection as a justified battle for cultural dominance, a way to try and force society as a whole to revert to the revisionist history of white supremacy and American exceptionalism. Now, this is a sermon, not a lecture, but I mention all of this history because whether it be a war, a pandemic, or some other event, the way that we remember it will shape the meaning that future generations will make out of it. And making meaning out of our heritage and history is the realm of religion. Religion at its best helps us understand the good and bad, the just and the unjust, the truths and the falsehoods that have brought us to this collective moment. It helps us understand what binds us together, what defines us as communities, what values are worth fighting for. Religion helps us understand our own story alongside the stories of others, and within many larger stories of generations and countries, eras and epochs. And at its best, religion also helps us move into faith by giving us a community to support us and the tools to choose how our story unfolds and informs the stories of others. This Memorial Day weekend, if you take away nothing else, let it be this. It is one thing to acknowledge the limits of particular times and places, and that modern attitudes and values cannot always be fairly imposed on those that went before. It is quite another to allow time and politics to equalize people who fought to preserve slavery and those who fought to end it. It is quite another to allow the horrors that the poor and working class have suffered disproportionately during this pandemic to be whitewashed away with claims that we were all in this together. It is quite another to be duped by both-siderism and dismiss those who enabled the January 6th insurrection as badly misled people who were just doing what they thought was right. Unitarian Universalism is a big tent faith, a tradition that embraces the right of conscience and wisdom from many sources. But I want to be as clear as I can be that this does not mean that anything goes. It does not mean we believe we must tolerate falsehood being masqueraded as truth. All stories are not equal. Some are untrue. And facts are not opinions to be dismissed when they are hard or inconvenient. Ours is a faith that demands we rigorously and resolutely resist evil and injustice while searching for truth and meaning. We are known for what we include, but what we embrace. But our boundaries are just as vital a part of what it means to be Unitarian Universalist. Thank God. Frederick Douglass wrote in our reading today, "If we ought to forget a war which has filled our land with widows and orphans, which has made stumps of men of the very flower of our youth, which has sent them on the journey of life armless, legless, maimed, and mutilated, which has piled up a debt heavier than a mountain of gold, swept uncounted thousands of men into bloody graves, and planted agony at a million hearthstones, I say, if this war is to be forgotten, I ask, in the name of all things sacred, what shall men remember?" So what shall we remember? Not only about the Civil War, but about today. What sacred stories shall we remember? Not just the ones passed down to us through legend and holy text, but the sacred stories being lived out today. Every time truth is proclaimed in the face of falsehood, everywhere people resist evil and make sacrifices for justice and equity, every place people choose to tell a fuller story than they might have learned at first, a fuller story with more voices and perspectives. May truth, love, and justice guide us as our stories unfold, and as we become the bearers of memory. May it be so, and may we make it so. Amen.
There is so much in this life we receive which we do nothing to earn. The beauty of nature, the inspiration of music and art, our very lives themselves. All of these things are gifts we receive. The Unitarian Universalist Church of Silver Spring is also a gift, founded and built by generations of people, some of whom live only in our memories. They created this community not only for themselves, but for all of us who receive its gifts of inspiration and learning, music and service today. And now it's our turn to give what each of us can to support the congregation and our community partners so that others can enjoy the gifts we have received in abundance. Sunday morning offerings are part of what makes our ministry's programs and mission possible. But most importantly, making an offering will allow you to practice generosity to contribute to a community that can do more good together than any of us can do alone. There are three ways you can make your financial gift to this congregation. The first is by downloading the Give Plus app from Vanco to set up an account. The second way is by using your phone to text a message to 833-880-1363. And if the app or texting just don't work for you, the third way is by mailing a check directly to the church. All of the information you need for all three of these methods is on your screen now and will appear again toward the end of today's service. I hope you will join me, in making an offering with gratitude for all of life's gifts and all that UUCSS means to you. The offering will now be given and received with joy.
The
May the gifts we have given fuel the flame of our commitment, empower us to serve out our mission, and give the life we share the shape of truth, love, and justice.
Good morning. Thank you for being here today. My name is Emily Harris, and I'm a member of the Board of Trustees at the Unitarian Universalist Church of Silver Spring. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. Our church is not only the organization that puts together these services, we are a vibrant community of volunteers and staff, a member of the Unitarian Universalist Association, and a part of the Global UU denomination. Visitors are especially welcome to our virtual coffee hour after the service to learn more about us. Today, we have three announcements. In-person flower ceremony. Everyone is invited to join Reverend Kristin on Saturday, June 5th in the church parking lot for an in-person extended flower ceremony ritual. Everyone will have a chance to sign up for a 20-minute window of time to come place your flower in a vase and take some seeds back home with you. And everyone who volunteered this year will be able to pick up a small token of Reverend Kristin's appreciation. Keep an eye out for the link to sign up. Goodbye drive-through for Marcia Thrall. Please join us in wishing Marcia Thrall a fond farewell on Saturday, June 12th from 3 to 5 in the afternoon in the church parking lot. Everyone is invited to make signs or decorate their cars so UUCSS can send Marcia off on her next adventure with our best wishes. Annual meeting. Please mark your calendars for our annual meeting on Sunday, June 13th, after the service. In fulfillment of our fifth principle, everyone is invited to attend, and all members in good standing are encouraged to participate and vote in our annual business meeting. The budget for the next church year, new members of the Leadership Development Committee, and new board members are all on the agenda. All members who have made a financial contribution in the last 15 months are eligible to vote at this meeting. The final agenda, supporting materials, and Zoom link will be sent to the entire congregation at the end of this month. The resolution to adopt the eighth principle will also be put before the congregation at our meeting on June 13th. You can find the language of the resolution, responses to frequently asked questions, and information about the meeting process on the UUCSS website. Today, Laura Ellis is here to share her thoughts about the eighth principle.
Hi, my name is Laura Ellis, and I am a member of UUCSS. I have loved history since I was very young. Growing up and living in the United States, I learned about slavery, lynching, segregation, racism, and other forms of oppression, and more recently about systemic racism. I participated in classes and workshops, including some here at UUCSS, but as a white person, I haven't had to think about it or worry about it all the time because I am white. Recently, I've become more aware of how embedded racism is in the United States and has been, say, since at least 1619. Unitarianism and Universalism, while they have roots in other countries, grew, developed, and became Unitarian Universalism in the United States. Our beliefs, our practices, our congregations, and our association are inescapably shaped by and affected by the systemic racism of this country. I believe in the seven principles, but I can read those principles and think about those principles as a white person without confronting the racism and other oppressions so integral to the United States. As an American faith, I believe that Unitarian Universalism needs a principle that clearly states where we stand in this struggle that has been a part of American history since the beginning and what we intend to do about it. As a Unitarian Universalist, I seek spiritual wholeness, and I am called to build and be a part of a diverse, multicultural, beloved community to be held accountable for working to dismantle racism and other oppressions. This is why I will be voting for UUCSS to adopt the Eighth Principle.
After the service, members of the Eighth Principle Task Force will be available in a coffee hour breakout room for anyone who would like to talk more about the Eighth Principle and the UUCSS resolution. We give thanks for all of the activities that enrich and enliven our congregational life.
If we want hope to survive in this world today, then every day we've got to pray on. If we want hope to survive in this world today, then if we want hope to survive in this world today.
Join me in the words of Chalice Extinguishing. Carry the flame of peace and love until we meet again.
May truth, love, and justice be in us and with us, and guide us as our stories unfold and as we become the bearers of memory. Our worship now has ended and our service begins.
Is the ancestors dwell in the doors of the water.